three. Morning.
Good morning.
All right, I'm gonna get started with you guys' permission. Let's get going, turn your cell phones down, please. I'm on myself too, for me. How's everyone?
Awesome.
Y'all starting to get busy? Time of year. So for our gratitude this morning, we're actually doing more of affirmations. What's the difference in an affirmation and a gratitude? What do you guys think about affirmations?
That's to bring on something you're grateful for.
Right, so we're grateful for what we have. We can be grateful for what we want or we're gonna get, but the affirmation side for me, as we've studied this in Ninja, I'm still kinda not there. So one thing I heard recently is I was working with an agent on limiting beliefs, or it might have been a staff member on limiting beliefs. And if you can determine what your limiting belief is, if you have been to Bold, you know what I'm talking about. That's a great thing to use your affirmation against. So say, like for my limiting belief, I say I'm not good enough. And that's a common one that I struggle with, and I go, I'm just not that good. And so, well, it's true. And so that's okay, because I can get better. And so then can my affirmation be around that? So anyway, we're doing an affirmation video this morning, and I'd love for you guys to share, post what your affirmations are that you're working on. Well, let's watch this video. You might have already seen it, but it's a good one.
Great. I can do anything good. I like my school. I like anything. I like my dad. I like my cousins. I like my aunts. I like my Allisons. I like my mom. I like my sisters. I like my dad.
So what if instead of saying I'm not good enough, I said I'm better than anyone, right? And then I started to believe it. I love that.
That almost makes me emotional.
Win. It's
a good one.
All right, so my prayer request. This is your prayer.
Weaver's doing prayer.
Okay, so Edie Untermeyer is doing well. She's doing physical therapy. It's a little painful. Please keep Edie in your prayers. If you guys don't know Edie because you haven't been here long enough, she's been an agent with Keller Williams forever, ever, ever. Most delightful person. And she had had a neck surgery that she's recovering from. Pal Griffin, is it okay to, Weaver, for you to talk about it?
Hal's in the hospital. He's been in and out of the hospital. He's been accepted actually to a program at MD Anderson, but they've got to get him up on his feet strong enough to get down there. So he definitely needs our prayers.
Hal needs some major, major prayers, okay? Carolyn Baker, her husband had a, was it a surgery or a bonus?
Yeah, he had foot surgery.
Foot surgery.
It was a very complicated surgery.
And so he is on the mend. Are your prayers are working? Please keep praying for him. His name is Roscoe, and he is on a walker, but he's getting better all the time. Nikki Lyle's doing well. He had a stroke, and he's, I don't know that you have therapy for that, but he has just still recovering and needs prayers. Jennifer Wheeler, continued prayers for her heart issue. She doesn't hardly talk about it very much. She is still needing prayers for her heart to get better, okay? And you know, as we talk about CPR today, we'll talk a little bit probably about some of that. Marsha Anderson is doing great. She's just been in the office. I find it remarkable when people just will not stop selling houses no matter what's going on with them. So she's been doing a lot of sales in the middle of her chemotherapy and beating cancer yet again.
Wow.
Keep her in her prayers. You're her in your prayers.
Thank you.
Shelly Faust, do you want to tell us how your daughter's doing?
She's on the mend. We go back to the doctor Thursday for new x-rays, and she's still not allowed to put any weight on her foot at all, so she's on her little scooter. But hopefully
will start, they'll let us know Thursday if she can start working towards rehabilitation to therapy.
And how are you holding up on all of that?
I'm good. She's actually becoming more independent, so she finished out school this semester with the 3.5 and registered for her last, so she's a senior, so she'll graduate in December. And she's actually going, she just went to the mall by herself, so, you know.
Good.
Yeah.
Those scooters are a blessing. And then Trisha Ellison, guys, she is our receptionist in Huntsville, the most delightful girl. Her mother has basically terminal cancer and is, that's just a hard, hard thing that family's going through. So please keep that family in your prayers and miracles do happen. All right. Anyone else on? Brian?
Yeah, prayed for my wife, Pamela. We went to the ER Thursday night. Swelling in the arm, pain, tightness in the chest, shortness of breath, textbook heart attack stuff. It is not that. So we spent the weekend in the ER or in the hospital, nothing. She's been released. She's beating children right now, teaching first grade, for those of you who are concerned. And we're just prayed that God guides the doctors to find out what's wrong so she can be back on her A game.
Yeah, they told her that she doesn't have, there's nothing wrong with her heart or lungs, but she's having shortness of breath for no apparent reason, so. Prayers for that. Anyone else?
I just want to say thank you for the prayers for a few months ago. Went in for stomach problems, and they took a CT scan, and I ended up finding out I had a cancer on the kidney. But they got it all, so.
He's on the men's. Anyone else? Okay, Weaver, can you take us?
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and ask that you bestow your grace and wisdom and help on all our loved ones and family and friends that have all these diseases and need help. Help each one of us move in these people's lives to do whatever we can to help them. Watch over us each and every day. Guide us and keep us in your spirit. Let everyone know that we are with you. We ask these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, so for our vendors, we have, let's start with Gateway. Want to talk to us?
Good morning. I'm Kathy Espy, Gateway Mortgage or in-house lender. Just wanted to let you remind you guys, and with Memorial Day coming up, that Gateway donates for every single loan that we close as a company to the Folds of Honor Foundation, which is the goes to the survivors of the veterans and their families to help them with their needs. So it's just Memorial Day coming up. I just wanted to remind you, we're very, very VA friendly, tech vet friendly, and we do service a big majority of the veterans' loans in Texas. So that's kind of one of our kind of stuff.
And tell them about your event that you're doing.
Oh, yes, June 4th. I haven't sent any invitations yet, but we're going to do a happy hour at Cedar Lodge. I believe it's a Tuesday. I'm sorry, I forgot to think about that.
I'm putting her on the spot, but make sure that you take a look at that and get a, you know, support her in her happy hour, and then she'll be probably supporting us by giving us something.
All kinds of
things.
And you'll be receiving invitations, and I have a co-sponsor with the title company, so we've got Donna participating with us. It'll be at Cedar Lodge, and you'll be receiving invitations as soon as my marketing department has them out. So we'll be doing door prizes and drinks and
Okay, so Texas Homeland, as you guys know, as she just said, they sponsor us all the time. They, you know, are they always there to open title for you and do such a great job. Make sure you're supporting them. Let's talk about home inspections.
Yeah.
You guys know Mike?
Hi, it's really good to be back again. Some new faces here, but glad to see old faces. We're going to have a drawing in a minute. If your business card's not the bulb, we'll just pass it from table to table and put it in. Matt Sultemeyer is your CPR instructor, and Matt and I have known each other for about 15 years or so. Yeah. We met each other doing prison ministry in the Darrington unit in Rochere. Now, if I remember right, on Matt's very first retirees retreat weekend, he sat at the table, and on one side of him was the black leader of the Crips gang for that unit. And on the right side of him was the white supremacist leader from the state of Texas.
Wow.
Yeah. Only God can do that. Only six inmates at that one table. And 1,800 inmates in that whole unit. By the time the weekend was over, these two guys had their arms around each other, loving on each other. The white man brought a Hispanic man to Christ that same weekend. It was just an awesome
indoctrination.
So, boy, talk about indoctrination by fire.
Yeah.
In the state of New Mexico, private schools are allowed to recruit high school athletes from across the state to be on the team. Public schools cannot. So as a result, private schools were winning the state championships year after year after year, decade after decade after decade. Until one year, there was a public high school coach that saw tremendous potential in the kids he had. But there was one problem. They knew private schools always won the state championship. And so we brought in Thomas Blackwell. And Thomas Blackwell came in and interviewed the guys. And he says, give me your name and why are you on this team? Oh, I'm on this team to play basketball, to have fun. None of them said they wanted to win the state championship. Until they got to the last boy. And the last boy had just recently moved there from out of state, and he didn't realize what private schools were doing. So when it's his turn, he says, I didn't come here to be on a negative team. I came here to win the state championship. And all the other boys just kind of looked at him in dismay. Who do you think you are? And so Thomas asked the guy, well, how many of the rest of you would like to win a state championship? And most of them raised their hands, some didn't. He says, until you make winning the state championship your goal, you will never attain it. And as long as what you say is not congruent with your goal, you'll never get there. So he asked the boys to make up a list of affirmations. And to say these affirmations when they get up out of bed in the morning, out loud, say them out loud before they go to bed, say them collectively as a team before every practice, say it as a team before every game. That first year, they made it to the playoffs. The next 2 years, they went to state and lost by 1 point to a private school.
Wow.
They would have never gotten that far if they ever made that going to state their goal. The football team found out what the basketball team was doing. They did the same thing. And they won state championship for 3 years in a row.
Wow. Amazing
works. I'm not going to read all of these. I'm just going to read the first couple. It's our destiny to win the state championship. It's not our goal. It's our destiny. That's where we're headed. What is your destiny as a realtor? What is your destiny as this real estate office? Keller Williams made it their destiny to be the number one real estate agency in the world, and they got there. What is your goal? Winning comes naturally to us. State champions is in our blood. And no one fights for victory as hard as we do. So one of the things you may want to consider doing is writing up a list of affirmations that you can have for yourself. What does it take for you to be the kind of realtor to get you to where you want to be? And then start reading those out loud when you get up, when you go to bed, maybe before every meeting. You'll be amazed at how far it takes you. This book is called The Liberty of Our Language Revealed. It's a great resource book. The subtitle is We Dream About What We Talk About. So if you talk about your dreams and your realities, eventually they will come true. So we're going to have a drawing for that in just a minute for this book. Somebody's going to get that. So Mike Lovely with Magnolia Home Inspections. Most of you guys know us. For those of you that don't, we're a one-stop shop. We do termite certification. We're certified to do well in septic, pool and spa, lawn and sprinklers. We're the only company I know that gets in the water to do piers, docks, and bulkheads. So as a result of that, we're doing a lot of high-end luxury homes around Lake Conroe. Our growth rate is about 100% from last year. Our goal as a company is to be a multi-inspector firm. So we're looking for an office now. Once we have an office, we're going to hire an office assistant to take the phone calls and schedule inspections. We plan to hire an additional inspector in winter. So down the road, our goal is to have about 10 inspectors working for us. So set your sights, set your goals. Somewhere in your packet materials, you'll see our flyer. So we're just asking for your business. We do some business with some of you guys. I think we've done it for Shelley Faust. We just booked one for Mike Berger yesterday. And we just love to do some more business with you guys. Great.
Thank you.
Let's go to the...
His emails too. I think they're so thoughtful, and I just love the deeper level, right, than just the "you, this is your inspector" stuff.
Mm-hmm. Confirmation call. Yeah. Does anybody know Mike besides Matt? Does anybody know? Got my email yesterday. Know what it's about?
I do.
Oh, then I need your business card.
Your business card. Look, his emails are good.
Yeah.
Can we get so many?
We're just put our house on the market yesterday.
What?
And, well, the reason for that, my wife was supposed to have back surgery. Luckily, she had physical therapy. That's been delayed indefinitely, thank goodness. But we need to get into a one-story house where she can get around. So that's the reason for putting our house on the market. All right. So.
Oh,
good Lord. That was fun.
Jan Helgoff. Can I take your tag to another line and give wave right for us?
Sure.
Just so I figured we've already done a whole. And I put you back in, so if you do one of those where you win twice, it's what it is. I'm just giving away this this give thanks to the Grateful Heart little board over here that I was going to give away at Fun Group, and then they said they didn't deserve a prize. Not that you guys didn't deserve one either, but you deserve one for attending. Jim Clark.
All right. Thank you again for having me. You guys have a blessed day.
Thank you.
Go give it.
Thank you. Okay, so let me ask you guys a question about mobile homes. Who in here has sold a property with a mobile home on it?
My lifetime.
In your lifetime, Teresa, I would know your answer, right? Who has never sold a mobile home? Okay, so a few of you. So, do you guys realize, and the one most of you raised your hands, so we had an issue with a file recently where did the land come with the mobile home? Is the property attached to the land? Brian would say it's a different process. So Ruth got some property together for some information together for us, and you should have it in front of you here.
Yeah.
I'd like you guys to put this in your arsenal. Who has it? I don't know if I have a copy here in front of me.
Is that really in
Huntsville? Manufactured housing guidelines. Wherever you guys keep your stuff, and it's on our intranet, and it's in our docs, and when you dust your brain off the next time you have a mobile, or you have a client asking you about mobile, or you're just basically go on a listing appointment, and that's what it has. Sometimes it's whether or not it has value. There's lots of things. So we've got some information for you for listings, for your contracts. If you don't know, you'll need a special lender. All kinds of good information, frequently asked questions. All the stuff that you will need will be there in your intranet and your dot loop and in your documents for yourselves. Okay? Just want to share that with you and have you realize that it's a different thing. Ruth, do you have anything to add?
No, but please read it because you might want to check and see if it's still got wheels or not. That would be something else to take a look at. There's just so many things that can turn up if you don't know if you're not competent to do it.
Well, and the deal was is can you put it in MLS if the land is not included? Is it real property or not if there's no land involved? Is it real property if there is land involved and it's not attached? You know, so this is the things that if you guys don't know, and even if you think you know, please read through that information and realize that we have that issue to deal with sometimes.
Well, if worst come to worst, they can call one of us and talk it through.
Sometimes you guys will ask, who do I ask for contract questions? Matt West is in the room. He is our specialist that knows the contract so well. He's the person that I would go to and that Ruth and I still do go to.
Oh, yes, he is.
And you can ask Ruth and I. We do our best to know stuff. Okay?
There is a place past Willis that's selling mobile homes on, but they're leasing the property for like $500 a month.
Yes, and do your clients realize that they don't own any real property then, right? You know? So it's kind of like buying and selling a car. Well, that you've got to contact the, like, say you've got a person that's in a certain price range or wants some land, or, you know, the clients that like that, and they say, hey, I'd like to get a land into a mobile home. Well, where's their resource? What's their financing look like? Can you make a commission on that? That's some questions that you guys should have here in your information. And you know, we could bring a lunch and learn or something to it. It's just whether or not you want it. Most of us, really, as realtors, we just need to understand how it works. So that if you do get into that, you have that. Now, who knows what Seller Shield is?
Seller's protection over their seller's disclosure.
So this is seller protection over your seller's disclosure. We introduced this for our office on purpose. There's a E&O, it is so hard, it's becoming harder and harder and harder for you guys to get E&O coverage. You might remember last year we had to raise the E&O pricing. You'll see it across the whole industry because why? More people are going into lawsuits, and what do they sue for? 85-90% have to do with your seller's disclosures. It's with disclosure. And then you as agents have protection against the seller's disclosure because if you don't know, you have it. And will you pay a deductible? What costs you money? What be time and effort? Would you hate it if you're in a lawsuit? Yes, yes, and yes. And then your seller is not covered. So, oh, they forgot that the bathtub leaked and they repaired it and now there's mold and, right? And then they're under a lawsuit. So this is designed to help them go all the way through the seller's disclosure. It's kind of like seller's disclosure insurance. Do we have a video, guys?
That's a service.
This is a service that costs you nothing, that protects your seller that they can opt in or out of. It's seller disclosure coverage for them. This place guarantees, basically, that they won't be sued.
So do they pay a premium?
The seller has a choice of what to pay. You guys should have all this in your email, but as you know, we missed those. So I'm just going to keep telling you. And then in the dot loop class, I've asked them to add it to it so you guys can find out we're there. Tiffany knows about it. Let's play this real quick.
Claire, do you mind?
No, not at all.
Welcome to Seller Shield. Let us show you how to get started as an agent. First, go to sellershield.com, click on agent sign-in. Select your state, then enter your license ID. If your account is not already set up, you can easily do so with your email and a password of your choosing. You can upgrade to premium to upload your headshot or click maybe later. Now you're ready to invite a new seller. Click here to begin. Enter the property information and the primary seller contact information. At the bottom of the form, you will have the option to purchase or decline home sale legal protection. Once you hit submit, your home seller will receive an email to access their disclosure. You will be able to view activity through your dashboard by clicking on the property address. You will be able to see what section your home seller is on, and more detailed activity can be found below. Once your home seller is complete and has signed, you will receive an email to access the completed disclosure through your dashboard. Open the PDF, then you can download or print.
So it's pretty easy, and then that handles their seller disclosure. You guys ever have a problem getting everything signed and every, you know, compliance that ever comes back? With the other agent, sometimes you have the same problem. So this just gets it all done, and then you just upload it right into your loop. It's not too difficult, and you can access it and see where they are in signing it. It really just opens up a window through the biggest parts of the seller disclosure and helps that client fill it out. Okay, Claire, you can turn back on. This is more information. You guys realize that you have an in-house closing coordinator that you can hire, Tiffany, she's right back there. Most of you know that. On the new agents, I've been having you work with her. She is there to be available to you. And
at no charge to us. She teaches adulthood classes and comes in and informs you guys and helps you. So please be aware that when you get busy, I know, Shelley, you gave her a little testimonial last team meeting that we talked about it, that you really found when you get slammed, that's
very
a great opportunity for you. That's why, you know, you guys may not be have enough business to have a permanent assistant, but you've just got that in the building that you can call up and have help you. ALC, so who could say that they enjoy Red Day? That was amazing, right? I just thought that place was incredible. It, I think whenever you think about the culture that you have, and we're so used to what a family we are. Anybody have any feedback on how they, is it an experience they had that day, or what they came out of that with? To me, it's so humbling.
Well, I found a permanent place where I could drop off all the stuff that I'm always getting rid of.
Yeah. Right, that we don't even really know. I didn't even know, like,
so
in my mind, that people
I have a box
use
in my
things.
Car that next time I go by and that's my way, I'll be dropping it off. So.
Yeah. Including towels and stuff.
Yeah. Well, what they're doing for the community, I mean, I just, it's amazing. It's amazing. And how the story that they told, I don't know if you guys were there, about how they were led, you know, God kind of led them to that building and location. Mm-hmm. So I just think that put the word out. We don't do a good enough job of telling our story of what the community needs and all of that. And how wonderful for you guys to be a part of that. So when I did, when Rhonda did and I did Agent of the Week this week, we wanted to recognize that.
Yeah, I was going to say that picture doesn't reflect the level or shade of red that Matt is right now.
I get like a scarlet color going on to this to them. Matt's one of those people that gets embarrassed, and so that makes it even more fun.
Oh, that's fun. Do that again.
So thank you for all that work that you did there, Matt, putting all that together. And I know the whole culture committee did, and it's not that, but you're always good around the office and such a wonderful addition to our family. So I want to go through some awards. I basically will do this once a month, right? So this is a month behind, it's April. And when I look at you guys as competitors, for us to realize that in 1 month we do things that other brokerages don't do in a whole year. Whenever we look at these units that some of these agents do, another agent may not do it in a whole year. If you guys, this is the Triple Crown. So to get on Triple Crown, 3 units per month, right? To get on the Triple Crown list, and then we do an event. I felt like I kind of blew you guys off last quarter where I did the crawfish boil and I didn't really recognize you as well as I'm supposed to. So I apologize, you guys gotta forgive me. And this is agents who have sold over 3 in April. Sellers Frankie, Home Branch, Story Team, Kane Team, Lady of the Lake 5, Burger Team, Hofstra Home Group, Shelley Faust, 8 in 1 month, all by herself.
Wow.
Ouch, right? And the daughter of injury. So Shelley, to me, is a great example of, she's so involved in the culture side of us, such a servant leader. And then when all of a sudden you're slammed with 8 contracts and your daughter had an accident and all of that, wow, right? Teresa Shive, another one, I don't know how you do it, it's 7.25, I'm not sure the 0.25. Paul Dahlberg, 6. Matt Nelson, 4. Marcia Anderson, 3. Jan Marks, 3. Congratulations. If you ever sit here in the room and think, man, I don't think I could do that, there's several examples up on this board of having been in business that long, etc. Listing volume, Frankie Team in 1 month, 4 something million. Kane Team. So what we'll do is pull kind of the groups, teams, and individuals, and the highest listing volume, for example, Teresa as an individual. Good job, Teresa. Good job, all of you. Listing units, Frankie Team 8, Kane Team 7, Teresa Scheib 5, Lori Parker 5. Do you guys think about how many listings you need to carry yourself towards that destiny that is your goal? How many do you need each month? Closed volume, sellers group, Kane Team, Paul Gomberg, closed volume in 1 month. Closed units. Sellers Group, Kane Team, Shelley Faust. Closed volume over 1 million. Sellers, Home Branch, Frankie Team, Story Team, Paul Gomberg by himself, Shelley Faust.
I just think that's amazing that you guys, it's not that it isn't amazing up at the top, because of course it is. I mean, those people have worked hard to get to those places, and you just think about all the 1 month that to do that. Listing volume, Frank team, Story team, Sellers Realty Group, Kane team, Lady of the Lake team, Teresa Shive, Katie Clayton, Lori Parker. Awesome, right? Let's just applaud yourselves. Proud of you. If you did really well and your name's not up there, it's just because we're taking the top ones. There are so many success stories all over the building. Mike Berger, congratulations on capping. Paul Gomberg, congratulations on capping. Okay, 66-day challenge. Who knows what it is?
You guys, come on, you know what it is.
You don't know what it is. A little bit of learning.
Girl, what is the 66-day challenge?
That's a pretty good description. Yeah. It's a little bit of learning about command. Every day.
And you can start at any time. You don't have to start it with the same.
So what does it mean? Why is it called 66 days? Does anybody know where that comes from?
There's 66 videos.
That's one reason. There's 66 videos.
Because it takes that long to create a habit.
So there's a book and a material that we have with Keller Williams called The One Thing. It's a book that Gary wrote. And in that research, because they researched it for years and years, they found that it takes 66 days to develop a habit. So if you will do something for 66 days in a row, you'll get in the habit of doing it. So say you're getting in the habit of working out, you're getting in the habit of brushing your teeth, you're getting in the habit of putting your moisturizer on, whatever it is. You do it for 66 days and you'll find that it comes in your mind to do it, right? So one of the team leaders in Keller Williams made us a spreadsheet with 66-day videos for command that are about 2 to 3 minutes each. You, like Terry was saying, it's a spreadsheet, it's pinned on the internet, and you can just go in for 66 days in a row, or you could do them all at once, or it wouldn't really matter, the idea is once a day. And watch a 2 to 3 minute video. And then my opinion is open the video on your phone or your device and have a screen of your, call it a laptop or a computer desktop, open with your command open. And sometimes it'll be with your Kelly app, which is just your mobile version of command. And if you'll watch a 2 or 3 minute video, you open it up, you look at it, it's not killing you to learn so much, and you'll, after you watch a few of them, go, oh, now I'm starting to get what is command. A lot of you are still asking me, I don't understand what command is. If you will pay attention to this, it's right on the intranet. Do me a favor, and next time I ask, say, yes, we know what it is. Yes, we've looked at it. So here is some insights. I said I was going to do a $100 prize. How many of you would like $100 right now? How many of you get an insight? That's what I discovered. I did. Greg, you did one?
Yeah.
So one thing I found, because I posted some as an example to you guys, so pull out your telephones, open up to Kelly. I mean, extend it again. Open up your Kelly app.
Yeah, I tried to do it and it wouldn't let me.
So what it is an insight? Who knows what an insight is? Craig? What is an insight?
Basically a local place or location that you can take photos of or describe for the community, just to, you know, some place you've been to, or you know, recommendation for the place.
So it reminds me a little bit of a Yelp review. It reminds me of when you're Googling a restaurant and you see which ones have the ratings. So you as an agent, you guys have your Kelly open? Can you get into it? Hold on, I'm not in mine. So open your home screen. Let me see theirs, because mine's, I don't have mine open. You see at the top how it has, okay. You guys see as you scroll down that your insights will be there. Do you see any?
Yep.
Okay, so this is your home screen. To get into your command, it's kind of like your favorite saved at the bottom. This is just the opening of your Kelly. So you should have right in front of you local insights near me. And then you'll have a couple of examples. And then if you guys will add a picture, it's going to have more value to you. Then when your consumer app comes for your clients who will be using the same app, you're helping them with their local information. They'll click on a map, and it's different than just restaurants near me. It's local businesses near me. It's valuable things in neighborhoods. It's dog parks. It's things like that that would be valuable to your consumers.
On the home screen, where do you go?
It, you should, as you scroll down on your home screen, see local insights near me.
So somebody posted Keller Williams on my inside.
Yeah.
Well, so...
And the Frankie team.
The Frankie team.
So one thing I said for you guys for your $100, there's a reason I'm having you do this, and if you guys will do it and go into the $100 contest, and you'll see, I don't want it to be about you and about Keller Williams. Do it about something that your client would find valuable.
I think we should do the $100, right, Craig?
Where is somewhere that you would recommend? And so say you're driving on your phone, you're driving or you're in a neighborhood, your clients are going to be looking at houses and they're going to see these insights of things nearby. It's all generated by the location of the phone. I'm going to keep telling you about it, and I mean, I'm offering $100. I'll tell you what, guys, I won the $100 myself. I'm giving it away to you guys instead of keeping it. And this is why I just, if I don't find it worth telling you about, right, it's, I'm telling you for a reason. I'm going to extend it 1 week and then post some more stuff. I posted 3 handy videos about what an insight is and how to do it. And I emailed it again yesterday, and it's on, it's on Facebook. Okay. Y'all killing me. A couple of events to tell you about. So right now we're on this team meeting here, right? They're involved. A lot of some of my people that did some insights are involved, and I told them they got to be present to win, so they were mad at me. And I was just kidding. I'm glad some of that should be involved. So you've got an ALC meeting tomorrow. Guys, that is like our board meeting for this office. Some of you have asked me, I don't quite understand what it is. It's where we go over the servant leadership in the buildings. We talk some about their businesses themselves as the leaders who give their time. And this is the people who make policies. Keller Williams is an agency run by the agents. They make the policies. You guys get involved in your committees, and then at the ALC meeting, we talk about those things. The Millionaire Real Estate Agent Book Club. How many of you have been listening in, realize that I'm doing it on a Zoom call so you can pick it up from your phone or from your house or while you're in the field? And we're on session 5. It would be very easy to catch up. We haven't gone over the massive amounts of content on that yet. It's getting through the Millionaire Real Estate Agent book together, collaborating, and there's it's all the foundations of your tools here. I'm really love to see you guys get involved in that. Your skills group number 3, so your ninja principles groups, you have a skill group every Thursday. This, you know, this calendar cuts it off. Biggest gap I see that I think you guys would really, your lives would change is to get listings. Who holds the listings inventory holds the market. And this one goes over the, I believe the listing.
16-step seller process.
16-step seller process. Ruth will be going over that this week. If you guys even have a best listing presentation I've ever seen, I would still say this will add to that. It's a mastery program course. And then the following week, on skill group number 4, going over the listing interview, Bruce Sellers has agreed to come in and do that for us. You got the number one listing agent in the office, I think, or at least one of. Going to do that for us, and he's going to be going over content you did this week. So. Tap into that, guys. I don't understand why you're not all there. It just blows my mind. I know you're busy, but that is some of the best material. And then your never-ending referrals. So many of you not paying attention to that. That is really one of the core building your database classes that we offer. Your mastermind Q&A, what this is where you guys are getting together and collaborating. You guys have the same challenges and needs and questions, and agents are getting together. There's a couple of people facilitating it. And just come in and say, I don't quite understand this or that, right? And helping other agents to success leaves clues and results through people. What else do I want to tell you about? Shelly, do you know what you're doing on the 29th yet? It says TBD.
Yeah, we're going to talk about the power of story and using your story to engage with potential clients.
You guys know what she's talking about a story?
That's the mom.
Are you talking about on social media, or are you
social
talking
media,
about
in the coffee shop, everywhere?
tell your story. Okay. So, sorry, that's, I guess that's something that I told you about, right? I have to give Earl credit for making all these adorable slides that I just went through. We'll be closed for Memorial Day. Prayer meetings, if you guys aren't aware of these, that go on at 5:15 every Monday. Talking about how special those are. Come in and get joined in on that. Okay, so I want to play you, well, I want to show you this. So I'm going to stand back here and read it with you. So this says, good evening, Chris. I apologize for not contacting you earlier regarding the sell your home, but we needed to sell our home quickly. We wanted a guaranteed and expeditious sale. We sold our home to Zillow. We went with Zillow for the following reasons. Zillow's offer was reasonable and fair. The sale was quick. From offer closing, the process took less than 3 weeks. We could set the move-in and closing date. Did not have to do any staging and make multiple viewings. Thank you for your updates in the past and something like, you know, thanks for everything you did and see ya. This is an agent that posted on Facebook from their client. Are you guys aware that Zillow is buying homes, listing homes, selling homes? Do you guys think it's in your market yet? Yes, it is. Okay. I want to do a whole class for you on how the iBuyer processes are affecting you. I want to just touch on it today because you guys are busy selling real estate. I'm watching it. We're watching it at a national and local level for you. So here's Gary's answer. I gave you guys an article that's from Inman. Now this article is not completely new, but it's one of the ones that I think if you're talking about and looking at this process. If you guys don't know, Keller Williams is getting in the iBuyer arena. Keller Williams has Keller Mortgage. You can get in the mortgage arena. This says, take a look at Keller Williams, Zillow would be Zillow killer. So it's basically talking about Command. Why do you guys care about Command? Command is a platform. Gary is spending $1 billion with a B to bring you guys a platform that will get the consumer before they make a decision to buy and sell and lead them all the way through until the closing, okay? And now more than ever, this matters to you. Are they going to be looking at iBuyer stuff? Are they going to land on Zillow? Are they going to see Zillow offers in this? Yes, they will. Talk to your clients about it. They don't understand it. You don't even really understand it. So this article right here, where I gave you guys to please read, you guys probably get this in your email boxes, or and maybe you don't, but where I said here, homeowners will have all Keller Williams data at their fingertips through the app. They can see in real time about their home, their neighbor's home, have hyper-local information about their neighborhoods. The difference in Command and HAR and whatever else you can name up here, and I can do a whole class on it, is your artificial intelligence to your clients. If you'll look on page, there's a little bit about millennials in here. It's a little bit about why we're doing it. Somebody asked me about the roadmap. This is all on your KW, but if you'll see, I don't know if these pages are numbered, but almost the last page, the roadmap, it's a little bitty writing here, but as we rolled out Command, listings and referral board, which you guys have, your Kelly dashboard, your Connect groups, you see where quarter three is when the consumer facing app will be released. There's so much information I'm going to bring you guys probably a 2-hour but I want you to have this information so that you can understand Opendoor, OfferPad, Redfin, Zillow offers, iBuyers. If you don't think that they're here, there's agents in our building doing deals with them.
They are. I was fortunate enough to get a listing last year in my subdivision in the Estates of Walden. They were going to go with door. Well, I called, they called me, talked to them, and they're supposed to call me the next day. She didn't call me, so I called her. And she said, well, I think we're going to go with door. And she said, they at least have to pay $5,000 up front and, you know, pay the selling agent, of course. But she said, I think we're going to do that. And I said, well, why would you do that? Why would you give them the money up front? Do you think they're really going to work for you? You're giving them the money up front. They don't even know Walden. They don't really, they're not even up here yet. I said, what happens if I get you $10,000 more? She said, well, that's a good point. I said, yeah. Anyway, so she called me back and she said, you win. We're going to go with you. And I did. We sold in 6 days.
So when you guys think about the value
proposition, your objection handling. This is another conversation that is going to, we're going to be having. I'll bring you more information on it. I wanted to talk to you about, let me show you this real quick video because I want to go to our CPR people. And this is kind of like, you know, you've got your eyes will glaze over a little bit, but it's 49 seconds. They're calling it a killer because to fight what Zillow is doing, Gary's going to get them before Zillow does, and it has to do with your neighborhood pages. It has to do with your AI at your local level. Zillow cannot be local the way we can, and neither can any of them.
Real estate is about helping people with one of the most fundamental aspects of their lives, home. And you are the expert they turn to. And not just when someone buys or sells, but before, after, and all the little spaces in between. So it can be frustrating when you don't have the time or technology to know when someone needs your help. And when you miss that opportunity, it creates a gap that someone or something else can step into. So let's close that gap and give you the time and technology you need to build high-quality relationships with more people. Let's join forces and demand our technology not replace us, but help us be more human, more present, more everything. Let's take Command, built exclusively by and for Keller Williams agents. Command is your do-it-all, do-it-quickly, people-centric, less stress, more time, end-to-end platform to grow your relationships, your pipeline, and your market share. Whew. Luckily, using it is a lot easier than explaining everything it does. But let's give it a try. Organize, customize, and sync all your contacts. Group them however you want. Know exactly who to reach out to, when, and about the things they really care about. Send personalized neighborhood-centric just-in-time marketing materials in a snap. Have more conversations, build more relationships, earn more business. Say, hey, Kelly, and escape from your desk in the office. Add a new contact, log notes, and sync everything while on the go. Seamlessly and transparently source, send, and manage referrals through one of the world's largest and most profitable referral networks. Deploy an ROI-maximized ad campaign across Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter in like 30 seconds. Integrate the systems and tools you already use every day. Automate paperwork and background tasks. Access real-time revenue projections, end-to-end ROI insights, and goal tracking to get a bird's-eye view of your business. Have more conversations, build more relationships, earn more business. Command empowers you to be a better agent by giving you more time, more value, and more freedom. And best of all, it ensures you and your relationship with your clients remain at the heart of real estate, where you belong.
Gary's really hard at work to keep us in the middle of this transaction and to help enable our relationships, not replace relationships. Okay, so speaking of relationships, I was in a conversation with, I don't know, Matthew, how did we get in conversation about CPR in the first place? We were talking and... So I guess it was because we were talking about if someone has a heart problem. I don't know if anybody has ever been in a situation where somebody maybe collapsed or you had to administer CPR. Somehow when Matthew were talking about this, he said something like, you know, you don't do mouth-to-mouth anymore. Well, I was a lifeguard in high school, and I was like, oh, yeah, you do the... No. Right? So we got a conversation about just bringing it to the office and talking. So you go up, Brian, if you, whatever you want to do, and let's hear what...
Come on.
What the guys want to talk to us about.
I'm not doing mouth-to-mouth for me. Yeah, mouth-to-mouth demonstration. He's going to be...
There you go.
So I am Matthew Saltemeyer, and I asked him to come in here today to kind of update you, or if way back in the back you used to do a class and you learned CPR, you got your little CPR card, and you were befuddled, okay, if they were this old, I did this many in the breaths and this deep, and the computer. Thankfully, in 2015, the American Heart Association, the American Red Cross got together, talked to each other, and they made it very simple. There's kids and there's adults. We're not going to go over the kids today because that's part of my four-hour course. I'm going to take a four-hour course, slam it in about 10, 15 minutes, go real, real quick. The pinch the nose, the pinch the mouth, even when it was required, a lot of people either just wouldn't do it because you're not putting your face on their face because it's their face, you don't know them. Or when it was done because you really wanted to, it wasn't done well. Sealing along the bottom part of the mouth is incredibly difficult. So you don't do it. came up in 2015 and changed it to, there's no more breaths, you don't do that. It's just pressing on the chest. The steps are, you go in, you see someone collapse, or you walk upon them and they have collapsed. You check, make sure that they really don't have a heart rate, really aren't breathing. The status, they always say, check and make sure it's safe. That's someone's attorney put that in there. If they're here in the hallway, it's probably a safe bet that this is a good place. First thing, you see them, you check on them. They need someone to do CPR. Well, that's you. You just volunteered to do CPR because you walked up on them. Tell someone to call 911. You need lots of friends that have lots of training, lots of cool tools. And Mr. Cannon will, you know, roll right in. And you don't do the just general, hey, somebody, you need to very specifically, like, well, I need you to call 911. Specifically to ask a specific individual. If you tell anybody to do everything, nobody's doing nothing. And then I need you to go get the AED. Because there'll be an AED hanging on the wall.
Well, so what if you're in a place where there's no AED?
Then you can't. You're at home. You're at an establishment, a restaurant that just doesn't have one. You just won't have one.
And what is it?
Unfortunate. An AED is an automatic external defibrillator. It's a little box about this big, weighs about a pound, and it shocks people. When appropriate, when a passive thing, you have two pads, one goes here, one goes here. The computer inside analyzes the heart rate and the heart rhythm.
Stand back.
After it analyzes, if it says, hey, I need to shock this person for their own good, the little machine will actually say, stand back, don't touch them. And you do what the machine says, don't touch them. And then it'll say, if it's completely automatic, it'll shock them. If it's not, if it's a semi-automatic one, it'll say, push the red button to shock. There's a big red button with a little lighting bolt on it, and push the red button. Fortunately, if you're in an establishment that has the AED, most of them will walk you right through it. It'll remind you, have someone call 911. Oh, I forgot that part. It'll remind you to, you know, do chest compressions. They even have a metronome on it to do the compressions at the correct rate. The new rate is about 100 a minute. How do you do 100 a minute? Staying alive. Get your old Bee Gees out. and that's about 100 a minute. And you can keep doing that. Kneel beside the person. Lock out your arms and start doing your Bee Gees. And right in the center of the chest. For women that have undergarments and other things in the way, you're going to have to expose and get the...
Okay, wait a minute.
hold better. So modesty is good. Try to maintain modesty when you can. So she brings the AED. You will now place the AED, and there's little pictures on it. These things are made simple. They're made to, you know, have someone that didn't take a class, didn't know anything, happened to stumble into it. All they did was pull the box off the wall. They turn the power on. It says, "Hey, call 911." I can do that. And it says, "Okay, do this." Okay, I'll do that. And it walks you right through the step. There's pictures on the pad. You got a picture of a chest right here, and you put it on the chest right here. The other one has a picture of the side of the book. You put it right here. You do that. And it says, you know, do the compressions. And it says, do compressions. And it'll tell you, stop. I'm analyzing. Don't touch it. You stop. You let it analyze. You don't touch it. If it says no shock advice, you don't shock. Go back to compressions and it'll tell you all these things and it walks you right through it. Very simple. If you're in the unfortunate situation that you don't have the AED, just do chest compressions. Have someone call 911 and just keep doing 100 a minute. And you don't have to do the breaths. You don't have to do anything. You are going to be a very important part of the component of just keeping circulation going. The reason they got away from the breaths is actually there's enough inner thoracic pressure whenever you start compressing. And there's enough volume, tidal volume, residual in the lungs. There's enough oxygen still going around. And some blood with some oxygen is a whole lot better than no blood with no oxygen. You're going to be able to keep them alive for the, if you're in Conroe, 5 to 7 minutes it's going to take for a first responder to actually get to you. Number two? There we go. So I tell you, their attorney told me to tell you, you have to make sure the scene is safe. If they're out in a puddle of water, you see electric arcing, obviously it's not safe. Are you okay? Are you okay? That's still the same as always been. Don't do chest compressions on someone who doesn't need chest compressions. If they swat your hand away.
How do you kind of know if they do or not? If they're passed
if you
out?
If you shake them and they kind of groggy, then you know. If you believe they might, check for a pulse. No pulse. Put your face, you can put your face near the mouth and you can look at their chest. Their chest is rising, falling, and at least they're breathing, and that's good. If you got no breathing, no pulse, then you have then you give the assignments. Call 911. Get the AED. Start doing the chest compressions. And you're gonna keep doing the chest compressions till either the AED starts shocking, professional help arrives, or you're just wore out and you can no longer do it. Luckily in this setting here, you're minutes away. You're gonna have Conroe Fire Department and Montgomery County Hospital that should be here in less than 10 minutes.
Well, but I was thinking like if we're at a property or a...
Yeah, if you're in the back behind Emerald Lake somewhere, you might be there a while. It's gonna take a minute. But the important part is you're gonna help maintain viability. You're gonna give someone a chance to be able to walk out of the hospital. City of Houston actually has a very high cardiac arrest survival rate, almost 25%. Wow. Thinking, wait, that's only 1 in 4. And that's world-class, top-notch rate. On standard out here behind Emerald Lakes, 10%, 8%. And that's measured if someone goes into sudden cardiac arrest, gets transported to the hospital, and within 30 days exits the hospital and walks home. And that's what we all want, you know, to be able to walk away from a horrific event and walk home and kiss your loved ones. The heel of the hand, that's hadn't changed whenever you were your high school lifeguard and everything else. Lock out the elbows and 100 times a minute. So you're gonna go quick. It's quick. You're gonna press down 2 inches, between 2 and 2.25 inches. No one's got a micrometer out there. And you know, you're saying, how deep is 2? Until you practice on some people, and I hope none of you ever have to practice on anyone, you're never really gonna know how deep 2 inches is. But just try to gauge about a 2-inch push. That's probably the hardest part of trying to teach these classes without a mannequin trying to do it in 15 minutes.
Where is the location that you're compressing? Where in the chest?
It was right between the nose.
Okay, on the chest plate itself.
Yeah, on the chest plate itself. It's just a nice, easy visual landmark is you can get the center of your hand right there between the nipples and push. If the AED does come and you have individuals who are incredibly hairy, that's a whole other difficult issue. Not many people keep an emergency razor in their back pocket to deal with the hair issue. If you can, you can try to adhere, it may not, and at that point it may not adhere. That individual is just too darn hairy and there's just not enough adhesive on that pad to get down through the forest, down the skin.
Or the sweat.
Yeah, you can take their own shirt, dry them. Undergarments, they can be worked around. Most time we do recommend just removal. If you don't do it, it's about to happen anyway when professionals get there. They're gonna take scissors and it's all coming off down to the waist anyway. You can provide for modesty. Provide for modesty the best you can. In the overall scene of everything where you have someone that just collapsed with sudden cardiac arrest and they're laying in front of you. While modesty is so important, it's lowered itself in the priority list somewhat. Check and make sure they're okay. Check and make sure that they need CPR. If they do, get the assignments, call 911, get an AED. Check. They need the CPR. You begin 100 a minute, interlace the fingers, middle of the chest, right in between the nipple line, push about 100 a minute. When you get 100 a minute, keep going. You don't have to give the rest. The professional help will come. If someone comes in and they're like, oh, I know how to do this, and they start doing the breath, that's not a horrible thing. They can do that. It's not a required thing. That's a little added bonus that.
So it'd be okay if somebody did do that.
Yeah. They'll do it. You're going to get 30 compressions. They're going to get 2 breaths. That's okay. Nothing wrong with that compression rate and that respiratory rate. You just need to, Ken showed up. He knows what he's doing. He can, jump in and help out with that. Or someone, former lifeguard, they've got their, but the thing is, a lot of people just don't want to put mouth to mouth because it's their mouth.
So you guys, Matthew was recommending that we have a AED around the office, and they're about $1,700, so I was just kind of looking at that as something would we want to raise money for with some different people in the building that have had heart issues. Man, I don't know that it's not a good idea to do. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was important that we could do something until 911 gets there, right?
Yeah.
What do you think, Ryan? Anything you want to add to it?
I mean, as far as like in the office, what he's talking about, in this big room here, with everybody in here, if somebody were to collapse in here, we don't need everybody in here for the modesty aspect of it. We can move several of these people out of here and have a couple of us know what we're doing, obviously, or whoever feels the most comfortable with it. But if it happens back here in one of these small offices, when the professionals do show up, there's a lot of equipment, a lot of people to be in there. So small rooms make it really tough for us. Typically, we're going to be pulling out into an open place. We'll have probably at least 4 guys all the way around him or her or whatnot, and it takes up quite a bit of space, so that's one of the things we're moving on. But like what you were saying earlier, never try to go without giving chest compressions. That is the number one thing. Even when we're in transit from the ground to the stretcher to the ambulance, ambulance to the hospital, we try to never, ever stop on that chest. Because nowadays with computers on them, they can tell how deep we're pressing on them, when we stopped, how long did we stop for, and they'll watch that whole entire scene and say, why did y'all stop for a minute right here? Well, we had spiral staircase of 3 stories we're trying to get down. There's just no way to do that. So the different rates, but like I'm saying, if somebody's back there behind a desk, start compressions on them, see if we can't move the desk out of the way without stopping the compressions. And regardless as to whether you can feel a pulse on them or not, if somebody's on their back or on their face here in the office, there's typically something wrong with them. Let's go ahead and call 911 immediately. But not the, is the breathing, is it, are they pulsing? Just go on and start them, come here. We can always say when they get here, oh, she was fine, she just was joking, whatever. Hopefully it's not the case.
So modesty is good. Try to maintain modesty when you can. So she brings the AED. You will now place the AED, and there's little pictures on it. These things are made simple. They're made to, have someone that didn't take a class, didn't know anything, happened to stumble into it. All they did was pull the box off the wall. They turn the power on. It says, "Hey, call 911." I can do that. And it says, "Okay, do this." Okay, I did that. And it walks you right through the step. There's pictures on the pad. You got a picture of a chest right here, and you put it on the chest right here. The other one has a picture of the side of the book. You put it right here. You do that. And it says, do the compressions. It says, do compressions. And it'll tell you, stop, I'm analyzing. Don't touch them. You stop. You let it analyze. You don't touch them. If it says no shock advice, you don't shock. Go back to compressions, and I'll tell you all these things, and it walks you right through it. Very simple. If you're in the unfortunate situation that you don't have the AED, just do chest compressions. Have someone call 911 and just keep doing 100 a minute. And you don't have to do the breaths. You don't have to do anything. You are going to be a very important part of the component of just keeping circulation going. The reason they got away from the breaths is actually there's enough intrathoracic pressure whenever you start compressing. And there's enough volume, tidal volume, residual in the lungs. There's enough oxygen still going around. And some blood with some oxygen is a whole lot better than no blood with no oxygen. You're going to be able to keep them alive for the, if you're in Conroe, 5 to 7 minutes it's going to take for a first responder to actually get to you. Number two? There we go. So I tell you, their attorney told me to tell you, you have to make sure the scene is safe. If they're out in a puddle of water, you see electric arcing, obviously it's not safe. Are you okay? Are you okay? That's still the same as always been. Don't do chest compressions on someone who doesn't need chest compressions. If they swat your hand away.
How do you kind of know if they do or not? If they're passed
if you
out?
If you shake them and they kind of groggy, there you go. If you believe they might, check for a pulse. No pulse. Put your face, you can put your face near the mouth and you can look at their chest. Their chest is rising, falling, and at least they're breathing, and that's good. If you have no breathing, no pulse, then you have then you give the assignments. Call 911. Get the AED. Start doing the chest compressions. And you're gonna keep doing the chest compressions till either the AED starts shocking, professional help arrives, or you're just wore out and you can no longer do it. Luckily in this setting here, you're minutes away. You're gonna have the Conroe Fire Department and Montgomery County Hospital that should be here in less than 10 minutes.
I was thinking like if we're at a property or a...
Yeah, if you're in the back behind Emerald Lake somewhere, you might be there a while. It's gonna take a minute. But the important part is you're gonna help maintain viability. You're gonna give someone a chance be able to walk out of the hospital. City of Houston actually has a very high cardiac arrest survival rate, almost 25%. Thinking, wait, that's only 1 in 4. And that's world-class, top-notch rate. On standard out here behind Emerald Lakes, 10%, 8%. And that's measured if someone goes into sudden cardiac arrest, gets transported to the hospital, and within 30 days exits the hospital and walks home. And that's what we all want, you know, to be able to walk away from a horrific event and walk home and kiss your loved ones. The heel of the hand, that's hadn't changed whenever you were your high school lifeguard and everything else. Lock out the elbows and 100 times a minute. So you're going to go quick. It's quick. You're going to press down about 2 inches, between 2 and 2.25 inches. No one's got a micrometer out there. You know, you're thinking, how deep is 2? Until you practice on some people, and I hope none of you ever have to practice on anyone, you're never really going to know how deep 2 inches is. But just try to gauge about a 2-inch push. That's probably the hardest part of trying to teach these classes without a mannequin trying to do it in 15 minutes.
Where is the location that you're compressing? Where on the chest?
You always, right between the nose.
Okay, on the chest plate itself.
Yeah, on the chest plate itself. It's just a nice, easy visual landmark is you can get the center of your hand right there between the nipples and push. If the AED does come and you have individuals who are incredibly hairy, That's a whole other difficult issue. Not many people keep an emergency razor in their back pocket to deal with the hair issue. If you can, you can try to adhere. It may not, and at that point, it may not adhere. This individual is just too darn hairy, and there's just not enough adhesive on that pad to get down through the forest, down the skin.
Right.
Or the sweat. Yeah,
they take the shirt off and dry.
Yeah, you can take their own shirt, dry them. Undergarments, they can be worked around. Most time, we do recommend just removal. If you don't do it, it's about to happen anyway when professionals get there. They're going to take scissors. It's all coming off down to the waist anyway. You can provide for modesty the best you can. In the overall scene of everything where you have someone that just collapsed with sudden cardiac arrest and they're laying in front of you, while modesty is so important, it's lowered itself in the priority list somewhat. You have a, check and make sure they're okay. Check and make sure that they need CPR. If they do, get the assignments, call 911, get an AED. Check. They need the CPR. You begin 100 a minute, interlace the fingers, middle of the chest, right in between the nipple line, push about 100 a minute. When you get 100 a minute, keep going. You don't have to give the rest. The professional help will come. If someone comes in and they're like, oh, I know how to do this, and they start doing the breath, that's not a horrible thing. They can do that. It's not a required thing. It's a little added bonus that.
So it'd be okay if somebody did do that.
Yeah. They'll do it. You're going to give 30 compressions. They're going to get 2 breaths. That's okay. Nothing wrong with that compression rate and that respiratory rate. You just need to, like, Tim showed up. He knows what he's doing. He can, you know, jump in and help out with that. Or someone, former lifeguard, they've got their, you know. But the thing is, a lot of people just don't want to put mouth to mouth because it's their mouth.
So you guys, Matthew was recommending that we have a AED around the office, and they're about $1,700, so I was just kind of looking at that as something would we want to raise money for with some different people in the building that have had heart issues. Man, I don't know that it's not a good idea to do. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was important that we could do something until 911 gets there, right?
Yeah.
What do you think, Ryan? Anything you want to add to
it? I mean, as far as like in the office, what he's talking about, in this big room here, with everybody in here, somebody were to collapse in here, we don't need everybody in here for the modesty aspect of it. We can move several of these people out of here and have a couple of us know what we're doing, obviously, or whoever feels the most comfortable with it. But if it happens back in one of these small offices, when the professionals do show up, there's a lot of equipment, a lot of people to be in there. So small rooms make it really tough for us. Typically, we're going to pull them out into an open place. We'll have probably at least 4 guys all the way around him or her or whatnot, and it takes up quite a bit of space, so that's one of the things we're moving on. But like what you were saying earlier, never try to go without giving chest compressions. That is the number one thing. Even when we're in transit from the ground to the stretcher to the ambulance, ambulance to the hospital, we try to never, ever stop on that chest. Because nowadays with computers on them, they can tell how deep we're pressing on them, when we stopped, how long did we stop for, and they'll watch that whole entire scene and say, why did y'all stop for a minute right here? Well, we had spiral staircase of 3 stories we're trying to get down. There's just no way to do that. So the different reasons, but like I'm saying, if somebody's back there behind a desk, start compressions on them, see if we can't move the desk out of the way without stopping the compressions. And regardless as to whether you can feel a pulse on them or not, if somebody's on their back or on their face here in the office, there's typically something wrong with them. Let's go ahead and call 911 immediately. But not the, is the breathing, is it, you know, are they pulsing? Just go on and start on the camera. We can always say when they get here, oh, she was fine, she just was joking, whatever. Hopefully it's not the case. But if it's a syncope episode, if it's a seizure, if it's any sort of them, if it's a diabetic problem, I mean, we want any of those versus the cardiac arrest, but now you've already got the help coming and started. And so everything else is spot on though.
I have a question. So what was the worst case scenario or the most common negative consequence of the mouth-to-mouth? Why was that such a big deal to go away?
Went away because most people just wouldn't do it.
Your mouth don't want to touch my mouth.
Or even when people were doing it, it wasn't extremely effective. The seal across the lower lip is difficult to make, and so people were still trying to do it. They had a little bit of confusion, and then they did research that there's enough tidal volume already in the lungs, and then with the interthoracic pressure, you're actually you're drawing air in anyway as a vacuum. So did away with a whole bunch of the weird, difficult stuff. Make it simple. I can do 100 compressions a minute and not even worry about the whole respiratory thing. Yeah, our docs are constantly on us.
Oh, within that too, if there is a couple of y'all here, so typically even with us training to know how to do it, we swap out every two or three times because we're doing different things. We swap out, so I may be doing compressions for a little while, and then he's going to say, all right, next swap, we're going to swap again. Because over a little while, you're going to get tired. So then your compression is going to get slower, you're going to get shallower, you're not going to be doing as good. So if there's three or four of you guys here, hey, you've been doing this for a minute, let me get in there and swap it out. And you get a fresh set of hands on them that's really getting in there doing correct compressions.
Well, guys, I so appreciate you coming and taking your time to talk to us about it. It's awesome. Maybe we should recognize like who in the room feels like they would be. There's probably more people trained in here than we know, but definitely I'm seeking you two guys. Something happens. All right, guys, that's it for the meeting. Anybody else have anything?
We have a virtual tour.
Virtual tour is next, so stay for that. Appreciate you. Have a great week.